Have you ever read a fact somewhere and just not believed it? This is Newlyn in Cornwall, in the far southwest of England. When the British government's maps say that a mountain peak is so many metres above sea level, they are talking about this sea level, the average sea level here. There's a little hut on that harbour wall, and underneath it, there is a narrow vertical well that connects to the ocean. So the height of the water in that well is the height of the tide. The waves don't make a difference. So for 6 years, 1915 to 1921, automatic equipment and human tidal observers measured the sea level here, and the average of all those measurements became the Newlyn datum, the zero point from which all heights in Britain are measured. The land here is solid granite, stable into deep time, so it seemed like a reasonable place to use as a baseline. So that's fine. That's all sensible. The fact that I didn't believe is this whole part of Britain, the whole Cornish Peninsula for hundreds of miles, rises up and falls down by several centimetres twice a day, measurably, because of the weight of the tides. Now, if that was true, it'd be common knowledge, surely. And wouldn't it cause earthquakes every day? I read that, and honestly, I didn't believe it, even as I looked round and started to find peer-reviewed papers about it. So I arranged a talk to one of the authors of one of those papers, a world expert on ocean tide loading, and yeah.
On some days, Cornwall might only move up and down by 3 or 4 centimetres compared to its sort of average position, whereas on other days, the movement might be 7 or 8 centimetres, so a total range of maybe even 15 centimetres. There's a horizontal movement that's about a third or so, typically, of the vertical movement in most places. So how we've measured the movement of Cornwall and other places is using GPS, the Global Positioning System, and we can measure that distance really very precisely indeed, at something like the 2 or 3 millimetre level of precision. Now, there are a lot of errors that cause a bias in this measurement that we have to deal with the effect of, for example, the change in speed of the radio signal as it goes through different layers in the Earth's atmosphere, and so on. But what we can do is we can make huge numbers of measurements of this. Our measurement of the average tidal motion becomes very, very accurate and precise indeed. So we measure that tidal signal, not just over one tidal cycle, but actually over a period of 3 or 4 years, maybe even as much as 10 or 12 years.
It makes sense, I guess, that the weight of water would compress what's underneath it. A few back-of-the-envelope calculations, you can work out that there are gigatons of water moving out there, in and out, twice a day. And yeah, at the most extreme high and low tides, this whole area can move as much as 6 or 7 centimetres up and down. But why does it happen here and not everywhere else?
The gravitational forces of the sun and the moon that are what's causing the ocean to move in the tides just happen to synchronize more or less in their timescale with the way in which the North Atlantic is able to move. It's just a little bit like if you have a glass of juice, that if you swirl it around at just the right speed, you can build up quite a big slosh around the edges of the glass. Whereas if you swirl it at completely the wrong speed, as it were, for that glass, then you get a much smaller amount of motion. Around the coastlines of the major oceans are the places where the tidal loading is generally larger. So around Western Europe, Greenland, and through to the Bay of Fundy, around the Atlantic coast there, around the Gulf of Alaska, and also around New Zealand. So the reason it doesn't start causing big things like earthquakes is, again, because these movements, although they add up to something appreciable and measurable by our new, modern, accurate techniques, are actually very small relative to the scale of the whole Earth. But that's sufficient for the most accurate engineering work to need to worry about this problem.
Thanks so much to Professor Clark. I've put links to him and to the papers that I read in the description.